Hi, welcome to the Data Science One podcast. This is Tyson. Today, I would like to present my new portfolio project on predicting puberty in the United States. So shall we start it? Before I do that, let me make a full screen mode. Okay, so let me briefly talk about myself. So I was a former business intelligence analyst at CAMH, which is mental health hospital, and I'm the machine learning enthusiast. And right now I'm the founder of the Data Science One YouTube channel. So these days I'm kicking some side machine learning project as all my own portfolio to get an entry level career in data science. So here is a brief agenda on what we'll be covering today. So let me briefly begin my talk with the background statistics about United States poverty. So as everyone knows, the population size in the United States is around 325.7 million. And then the poverty rate reported back in 2016 was 14% based on the federal government defined threshold. And then from 2012 to 2016, the number percentage of high school dropout found is around 13%. And then average income in 2016 was 49,000. And then finally, the unemployment rate in 2017 was 4.4%. So why should you care about this problem? So there has been an increase in poverty rate over time. Second, we want to tackle root causes of poverty in the United States. Third, define anti-poverty strategy in the United States. So the major stakeholder for this project will be US federal state government agency and US county economy representatives, and finally, not-for-profit organization. So the main goal of this project is to predict poverty across United States using socioeconomic indicators with the following two main objectives. First, make a comparison between low versus high poverty rate counties. Second, provide a practical recommendation on how to improve poverty rates among United States counties. So let's have a look at the data set overview. So this data set comes with the 33 input feature for predicting poverty rate. And then the data source was actually sourced from the US Department of the Agricultural Economic Research Service, known as USDA. And then the sample size of this data was around 3,200 rows, with the 30 numerical and 3 categorical features, which contains information about the urbanization degree, economic, health, and the demographic indicators. So in the middle, you can see the sample snapshot of how the data set looked like with the input feature and the target variable. And there are some major challenges with the data set was there are some missing values and outliers and the duplicates. So let's move on to the data wrangling pipeline. So before I do that, let me break down the high-level overview of the model workflow. So this model was built in two stages. So stage one is focused on model training and tuning. So basically, raw data gets loaded, and then we execute the data wrangling step. And then we are going to execute the data partition step to split the data set into the training, validation set, and the test set. So using a training set, we're going to build and train our model. Then after the model gets trained, we're going to use our validation set to further validate and optimize the model parameter to get the best model. So on the second stage, once we get the best model, then we're going to use a holdout test set from the earlier data partition step to fit to test against that model to get the result, and then compare across the different regression models of our choices. Now, let me briefly talk about the data wrangling pipeline in a four major steps. So as I mentioned before, the raw data gets loaded onto the Python as a data frame. Second, we're going to execute the missing value replacement. Third, we're going to handle some outliers. And finally, we're going to apply some feature transformation techniques, which I'll cover in more detail right now. So for missing value replacement, there are two different scenarios where you can apply different methodology. So for example, if we look at the method one, the feature removal. So let's say we computed for each feature, how many of the observations are actually missing. So let's say then we define our threshold as a 50%. So basically what that means is if any feature is missing more than 50%, we're gonna drop them out because it's not gonna be, you know, any meaningful value to your data set and towards your model, building your model. So after we've done the method one, applying method one, we're gonna apply a feature amputation on the remaining set of feature. So from basically left to right, so you can see that the table with the, you know, missing values, and then after we apply feature imputation, we get the, you know, all the values filled using appropriate method for each feature. So basically, for example, for numerical feature, it is very common practice to apply mean or the median, depends on the situation. And for any categorical feature, usually get replaced by the mode. So now moving on to handling outliers. So there are a few methodology to deal with the outliers. So first one is intercortex range. Second one is applying standard deviation. Third one is Z-score. And finally, there's some kind of linear model. So for example, if you look at the right-hand side figure, it's representing the box whisker plot for number of dentists per United States. Basically, this box plot highlights the five important stats, mean, median, max, and then your first quartile and third quartile. Excuse me. So if we use third quartile and fourth quartile, we can compute something called interquartile range, which is just subtraction from your 70th percentile minus the 25th percentile. So using this interquartile range, we can compute the upper bound and the lower bound boundary. So basically the idea is that any observation will be treated as outliers and they will be removed if they're sitting above or beyond these boundaries, below these boundaries. So now moving on to feature transformation. So first I want to talk about the feature scaling. So feature scaling is a very common practice step in which we're gonna apply a scalar function towards the numerical feature to basically convert the range of the features into the much more narrower range. So as you can see on the left to right histogram is showing a population per number of dentists. The only difference between two histograms is the range of the scale on the x-axis, which is population per number of dentists. And the next step is a feature encoding. Feature encoding is another very important step, is basically converting the categorical feature into the numerical format using some dummy variable. So as you can see on the example, on this table, the urbanization degree feature gets converted into multiple dummy variable as Node Metro A, Node Metro B, Metro A, and Metro B, as an example. Now, the last step is the feature engineering. So feature engineering is another crucial step in some kind of, depends on your business problem, your machine learning model. So what it does is we're using an existing feature to create a new feature. So as an example, if we look at this table, the urbanization degree encoded by some numerical feature, 1 to 6. So using some cutoff value, we can actually separate them into two different categories, one as being non-metro, and the other one as being a metro county classes. So now let's move on to the exploratory data analysis to get some of the major insight that I found from these exercises. So first one is showing the four histogram, the distribution by multiple socioeconomic factor. So first one that I want to highlight here is that the histogram distribution of person initial autos within US county is very close to normal, but slightly skewed to the right. And then surprisingly, the second distribution for the person diabetes is showing a normal distribution, with the majority of the US county being 10% of population are diabetic. And then the rest of the two histogram on the bottom for distribution for physician per population, and then person high school dropout is showing a distribution that are extremely skewed to the right. So now let's talk about the box whisker plot. So this box whisker plot is actually showing the US poverty rate by different economic typology. So what I mean by that is, as you can see on the y-axis is a poverty rate, and the x-axis showing different counties' economic dependency or the model. So basically, the main thing I wanna highlight here is that the highest poverty rate were observed from federal state government dependent counties, followed by the non-specialized counties. And then the lowest poverty rates are observed between the recreation and farm-dependent counties. Now, moving on, so this is the mean poverty bar chart by different urbanization degree. So from y-axis is showing the mean poverty rate, and the x-axis showing different urbanization degree by categorical feature. So from non-metro to metro, so the highest poverty rates are observed between non-metro with the population size about 2,500 to 19,000, with the 18.2%. And the metro county over 1 million population, the poverty rates are observed as 12.8%. So now move on to the, so this is a multi-dimensional scatter plot that I plotted using Seaborn Matplot library. So the y-axis is showing percent civilian labor among US counties. And then the x-axis is showing for a different education level. So from the left to right, the major thing I want to highlight here is that as the education level increases, obviously we're seeing the, you know, increase in percent civilian labor within the US county market, labor market. And also the other thing I want to note here is that the scatter plot is actually colored by the poverty rate level. So you will see actually with the increase in education level, the, you know, lower poverty rates are actually observed, and the vice versa for the high school percentage of high school dropout. So now this is the correlation metrics. So this is a simplified version of correlation metrics that I plotted using 10 important useful feature. So basically the correlation metric is showing correlation between the input feature and our target, which is the poverty rate. So the take-home message that I want to highlight here is that the most strong positive correlation were observed between percentage of the high school dropout with the correlation value of 0.68. And then the most negative correlations were found with the percent civilian labor with the correlation value of minus 0.66. So now let's talk about the model selection and some of the results that we got from this analysis. So for model selection, I ended up testing 5 different models. So first one is linear regression, which is trying to model the relationship between your input features and the continuous target variable in a linear fashion. And the second model is the polynomial regression, as you can see on the equation. So that it's trying to model the relationship between the input features and continuous target variable as well. But then the difference is that it contains additional polynomial degree term, which is power of 2. And then the third model is decision tree. So the decision tree, the idea is similar to the decision tree classification, but the difference is that it's trying to fit the regression on the target variable using each input feature to split the data. Then at each split, the sum of square error is compared. Then feature resulted in the lowest sum of square error is selected as your major node. And this process is actually get repeated until it covered the entire data. And then the fourth model is the random forest. It's a type of ensemble learning model, creates many decision tree regressions. And then we are just averaging the performance of this decision tree regression. And then the finally is the gradient boost. It's the sequential type of training regression model in a stepwise forward fashion. So basically what it does is it at each state or the each step, it tries to learn the mistake from the previous model's residual error to minimize the the potential error on the final model fit. Now, let's talk about some of the feature selection. So since we have too many input feature, we want to narrow it down, you know, which ones are actually useful feature. So there are two different techniques we can utilize, is that the L1 lasso regularization, and the other one is leech regularization. So basically the take-home message here is that on the highlighted, the green box is showing the top 5 important feature based on the estimated coefficient, the magnitude of the estimated coefficient value for each feature. Moving on, so this is a feature selection module. It's called feature importance, which is available on the decision tree random forest and the XGBoost model. So the idea is basically same here. So on the y-axis is showing the feature importance score. The x-axis is showing the each feature name. So the highlighted green box is also showing the top five important features that are selected by each model. And then there's some commonality between them, is that basically it picked among the top five important feature as the percentage of high school dropout, percentage of civilian labor, and the unemployment rate as well. So now, finally, let's talk about the model evaluation using root-mean square error and R-square metric. So here are two different bar charts showing for root-mean square error and the R-square value. So the major take-home message here is that the polynomial regression model was selected as the best model based on the result from the test set with the root-mean square error of 3.01 and then R-square value of 0.7994. Now, this is the same thing for showing the similar idea that the model evaluation in terms of the visualization perspective. So left one is showing the predicted property rate versus the original plot, original property rate. And then the right figure is showing the residual property rate plot. So basically, as you can see on the left figure, that it's showing a quite decent linear fit, meaning the model is quite well fitted. And then on the right figure, it's showing the residual property rate. So the major take-home message that I want to highlight here from the residual plot is that the highest residual errors are found in a property rate range within a higher range than the lower range of the property rate values. So here is a brief summary on our property regression model. So again, the goal was to make accurate predictions on property rate across US counties. And in terms of result, so using a feature selection module or the method, we actually selected a best info feature and then train each model. And then polynomial regression model performed best with the root mean square error of 3.01 and the R-square value of 0.794. And the risk and mitigation here was that the risk, in terms of risk, there are some errors on the predicted property rate from lower and upper range of property level. And then in terms of mitigation, we need to review identified error by taking few samples and validate with the subject matter expert before making any decisions. So the next step will be applying some model improvement and the data collection and refinement. So let's talk about the future work and recommendation. So first, let me talk about the limitation. So as we can see on the data set, it didn't have any financial information, like including the major county income household level, and then how much taxes are actually paid by different counties. And then there are no geographical information to actually distinguish which counties are actually representing the California or New York. And also the other thing is there are no temporal information to explain the trends or the seasonality of the property rate. So the future work is the model improvement. So basically using different ensemble models or the stacking approach, which is a little bit more advanced technique. And then the second thing is the data collection and refinement. Basically try to integrate with the more relevant key data sources, for example, household income, job market trends, other key performance indicator related to the basic needs, for example, food, housing, etc. So here are two main practical recommendations that I'd like to recommend based on the analysis. Was first, develop economic plan for the non-metro counties. For example, we need to help them establish their own industry or the economic model to relieve the property rate. So for example, non-metro especially on non-metro county with non-specialized model, and also the non-metro county with the federal state government dependent county model. And then the second thing is maintain a good transportation infrastructure. So basically we found that the counties that are adjacent to the metro areas and the large population size tend to have lower percentage of the property rate. I think this is kind of makes sense because bigger the city, there are bigger job opening pools and more jobs are available. So maybe that's the reason why we're observing lower property rates, relatively lower property rates compared to the non-metro counties area. Well, thank you for listening to this podcast. I hope you guys actually enjoyed it. And for more information, please check out this portfolio link on this US property regression. You will find more detailed analysis and the explanation. Thank you so much. And see you guys next time.